Blog Talk Radio.
Monica Leal, welcoming you to this special edition of the LL Research Radio Program In the Now, Q&A with Carla L. Ruckert. Today is Friday, March 30th, 2012. Carla L. Ruckert is an author, mystic, seeker, and primary channel for LL Research. You can visit LL Research's websites, llresearch.org and bringforth.org. That's bring, the number 4, th.org. We have a special guest tonight, Toby Wheelock, who will be talking to us tonight about the Law of One Re-Listening Project. Toby Wheelock discovered the raw material at Borders Bookstore in Ann Arbor, Michigan in 1988. He was in Ann Arbor for law school. Little did he know that the law he would be spending more time studying would be the Law of One. Most of us who study the Law of One are quite familiar with the reference site, lawofone.info. It is used quite frequently in discussions over at bringforth.org to reference quotes to back up points made about our understanding and interpretation of the Law of One. Well, we can all thank Toby Wheelock for that. Toby created this database back in 2003 to make studying the Law of One easier. He had shown it to Carla, and she encouraged him to make it publicly available. And the rest, as they say, is history. We depend on lawofone.info a great deal, and we're very thankful to Toby. In 2004, Toby decided to add the Book 5 material to lawofone.info, only to discover that in order to add that material into each session in the order in which it occurred, he needed to re-listen to each session. That's how the re-listening project got started. Toby will share his experience with the Raw Contact Re-Listening Project and discuss the effort currently underway to create a single-volume scholar edition of the Law of One books. Toby, I understand you're working on an update to lawofone.info that will include a re-listened version there instead of at a separate site as it is now. Is that right?
That's right.
Okay, wonderful. We are going to talk quite a bit more about that. And Carla, just wanted to make sure you're with us.
I am.
All right. Excellent. We're going to have a special show tonight talking specifically about this re-listening project. So we would like to ask our listeners to only call in if you have a question specifically about the re-listening project. Normally we take questions regarding any sort of spiritual issues, but tonight we're going to be focused on the re-listening project. If you would like to call in with a question for either Carla or Toby regarding this, you can call 646-595-2294. That's 646-595-2294. And be sure to hit the one key to let us know you'd like to ask your question live on the air. But first, I'm going to start with our opening riff that Carla chose for tonight. And you will see why once I read this to you. As you're listening to this, all of you Law of One scholars out there, see if you can detect something different. This is from Raw Session 95, Question 4. Questioner, thank you. The new room that we choose for this working will, of course, be carefully cleaned and marred surfaces made well. We shall also use the banishing ritual of the lesser pentagram prior to a working. Is there anything else that Ra could suggest? I would like also to know if there's anything in particular that you might suggest with respect to the particular place that has been chosen for our new location. I am Ra. We scan the recent memory configurations of the questioner. Firstly, there have been some less than harmonious interactions within this dwelling. The dynamics of this interaction were potent enough to attract a lesser thought form. Therefore, we suggest the salting and ritual cleansing by blessed water of all windows and doorways which offer audit into the docimil or any outbuildings thereof. Further, we suggest the hanging of the cut garlic clove in the portion of the room which has accommodated those whose enjoyment has turned into a darker emotion, centering upon the area we find you call the wet bar. Also, the room intended for the sleeping, which is found near the kitchen area. The appropriate words used to bid farewell to those of the lower astral shall be used in connection with the hanging of the garlic cloves for the period of approximately 36 of your hours. We believe that this is equivalent to two of your night periods and one of your lit periods. This should cleanse the house as you find it to the extent that it is neutral in its vibrations. We suggest that you then request of this living entity that it now be welcoming and absorbent for the vibrations of harmony, love, and thanksgiving, which this group shall then, as this incarnational experience proceeds, offer to the domicile. The extra phrase which Toby captured shows the Confederation's underlying concept about the house. Carla, would you like to expound upon that a bit?
I would. And when I thought about the opening riff for today, I wondered, well, what of the phrases that Toby recaptured from the original tapes changed the timbre, the meaning, the nuance of the answer that the Ra group was giving? And this was the first example that he offered, and I liked it a lot. Now, of course, all of this long thing about, you know, cleansing the room and making it ready for magic, obviously we're assuming that everything's alive. We're assuming that this is a magical ritual that we're working on, and we're attempting to hit the mark as far as being able to be in our magical personalities and being ready for the sessions. But there were two places in the last two sentences where the word vibration was used, and I think that's how come the scribe missed this phrase. Because, you know, when you're typing and then you have to go back, you're usually listening for a word, and you could easily enough miss this phrase just in the process of typing it for the first time. I imagine that's what happened. And it makes sense in its own way if you don't have the added phrase. But the added phrase was, we suggest that you then request of this living entity that it now be welcoming and absorbent, indicating that the house is a living entity, indicating that everything that we think of as basically inert, motionless, is actually alive. Now, I have always felt that this was true. I grew up believing in my grandmother's wonderful philosophy of resistentialism. She just said that items were jealous of us for being able to move around, and so they resisted. And so the bread always felt butter side down and so forth, and that was the resistentialism. But imagine the difference in the world between a house being a place where you as a living entity act as an actor on a stage, but the stage is irrelevant, and you as a living entity interacting with a living entity of a house to create the one unique and ever of all time vibrations of you and that house together. As it happens, we did not ever move into that house. That house was not to be. It was only 3 miles from the airport. It made too much sense. Instead, we came back here to Louisville because Don just was so hungry for Louisville, and we found the house that we're living in now. But we didn't get to stay here very long with Don because he died the next year. So anyway, that house would never have been the kind of vibrational place that this is, because of the fact that in that house, the previous tenants had been some members of the New Orleans Saints, that team, and their loved ones, and they had had a shooting there, and it was fairly violent. Also, the house led directly into the stable. It was an odd house. And so there was no way you could keep things really clean. So I was just as glad that we didn't get that place. And we ended up here, but sadly enough, I think we only did maybe one session here before Don became too ill to be able to do sessions. So that was the end of that. But at any rate, that is a wonderful example of the kind of thing that Toki has been able to add to this. Now, of course, if you're not crazy about the Law of One, you're not going to think that the addition of a phrase here and a sentence there is going to be that exciting. But if you've actually gotten into the material and you've worked with it some and you see how it works and you see how everything fits together, and then you see that something else is added like this also fits right in, it's exciting. It really is. So, Toby, I am so thrilled that you were able to do this for us. Why don't you tell us a little bit more about that project?
Thanks, Carla. And I think you're right about how the line got dropped. And there are a few others that are similar. And I think I'll get to those, but maybe first I'll just give a little background of Monica talked about how it all got started. It's interesting because I'm bringing forth just, I think, today or yesterday, a chat room, functioning chat room has been added. And this project actually started in a previous iteration of Bring Forth in its chat room. It was 2003, and at that point, Carla and Jim had opened their house up to a number of young, mostly young seekers. And one of them was a man named Bruce Perret, and he participated in that previous Bring Forth forums. And there was a guy, a poster, who's still active, named Zen Master, who's a friend of Bruce's. And the two of them were in a chat session, and I tuned in. And they were talking about, chatting about, wouldn't it be nice to have a wiki where questions that are raised again and again in the forums can be addressed and worked out, and so you don't have to answer the same questions repeatedly. And I just kind of out of left field chimed in and said, hey, Bruce, by the way, do you know I have this website, lawofone.info, and I'd like to add back the Book 5 material, but I want to put it in the right place. I don't know if it came out at the beginning of the session or the middle or the end. And Bruce said, no, I don't know, and I don't think anyone does. The only way to find out would be listen to the tapes. And I kind of gulped and said, okay, because I really did want to do that. I really loved being able to find what I had remembered by looking it up at lawofone.info. And I wanted that material, but I wanted it in the right place. And so a few weeks later, a box of tapes arrived in the mail, and they were copies. I think they were actually copies of copies. I think the original tapes maybe at that point were still sealed, and so I got these second generation tapes, which were audible, but the first 17 sessions were very faint, and I listened to them on I think a lot like Jim did. There's a picture of Jim transcribing, and I had a little portable tape player also, and very quickly kind of got hooked, because right in the first session there are some interesting differences, and there are a couple of these lines, like the one about the house, that were dropped and add a lot when you read them. There's a line about dancing thoughts that I really like, and some of these I have added back to lawofone.info. Some of them I still haven't yet, and that's part of the update I'm working on. But so right in the very first answer, Ra said, you are part of a thought. You are dancing in a ballroom in which there's no material. You are dancing thoughts. And so I'm reading along the transcript, and I'm realizing, hey, we're going off-road here. This is kind of cool. And I think that was that was it. I was, you know, I was hooked at that point. There were two other in that first session lines that had been dropped. Maybe one, I don't know if this was intentional or not, but Ross said, "We too have our place. We are not those of the love or the light." And, of course, what they meant was they are those of the law of one, of unity, not fourth density or love or fifth density or light. But when you read it, it sounds maybe a little alarming if they're not those of the love of the light. So I don't know. And you guys probably don't remember.
No, we wouldn't have taken anything like that out.
You
it would have only been if it was sensationalistic or personal.
Okay. So that was just, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think maybe what happened, my theory actually is that Jim probably transcribed it right, and then, as I understand it, you guys sent Jim's transcripts off to be typeset. And
right.
So somebody would have read it and then entered it into a typesetting system. And,
right.
And like you said, the house, that there's two lines that end with vibrations. And I'm thinking it might have just been an eye skip. It jumped from one line, then ended in vibrations to the next.
Yep, yep.
Just skipped it.
Well, that's interesting, because when I first read it, I thought, wow, did they take that out because it sounded so radical? But, hey, I guess it's not anywhere
little,
radical.
Yeah.
It's not anywhere radical than all the other stuff in the Law of One, so.
Yeah.
Really.
So Bruce and Zen Master had set up this wiki, and I had found these changes and wanted a place to upload them. And the lawofone.info actually is not super easy to make changes to, because each question and answer is a separate record in the database. And it was easier just to read along, make the changes, and then copy and paste the whole session to the wiki. And so that's what I did. And the wiki, kind of in the meantime, it started out where they were adding content, and then I think, you know, things happen and people find other focuses. So that part of it never really flourished, but I kept plugging along and uploading these changes. So currently that is the place to read the re-listened version. But the goal all along has been to incorporate it back into lawofone.info, and I'm very close to being able to do that.
Yay.
So I
could you state that site again, so they can make sure they got it?
The re-listen material is currently at wiki.lawofone.info.
Okay.
It actually started as, I think Bruce and Zen Master registered wiki.lawofone.org with one, the number one. And then it actually was wiki.bringforth.org for a while. And then once there was really nothing happening on it, Carla was just, you know, ready to consolidate Bring Forth into just its current form. And so the wiki, I moved it to wiki.lawofone.info. So I plugged along, and it's slow going. I found it slow going to listen and mark changes, because I found myself, you know, stopping to think about what Ra was saying.
Mm-hmm.
And also, just to try to be clear that I was getting it right, there's a lot of back and forth. So I probably only did, I don't know, 20 sessions in a good year. And eventually, in maybe 2006, a guy named Terry Sue, who was a long-standing friend of LL Researchers, got excited about it. And he was a great help to me, because he would basically nag me and say, "Hey, Toby, done any sessions recently?" And in 2007, Gary Bean digitized the tapes. He copied them to CD, and then created MP3 versions. And Terry actually started listening to those. And so he, for session 75 through 106, he did a first cut. And then I started from his version and made a next version. And so the protocol has gotten more rigorous as we went on. Terry introduced the convention, which I'm now using, of indicating blank spots, because there are some blank spots, mostly because when Jim taped the sessions, he used 3 cassettes and staggered them so that nothing will be missed. So in each session at around the 45-minute mark, you hear click of a tape running out and then being flipped and started again. But they only saved 1 of each tape. So the tape that saved, there's a blank spot right around the 45-minute mark. And Terry indicated that, which I hadn't been doing, and I thought that was a good idea, so I started doing it too.
And I want to interrupt and just point out that this is one of the many L&L projects that bring people together from all over the world. Terry is in Taiwan.
Yeah.
And our Toby is from Virginia. So when when people want to serve and help seekers at L&L Research, you know, you can really dig down deep, find your roots, find what you want to do, and then, you know, this has taken both of them years. And it's such a blessing to L&L Research. Go ahead.
And Terry and I now exchange Christmas cards, which is fun.
Yeah. He's a sweetie. He came and visited for a couple of weeks. Yeah.
I think he might actually have made the second. So I got a first batch of about 17 tapes, and then then the rest of them came in one big box, maybe, you know, 6 months later.
He may have.
I think it was actually Terry and his girlfriend that that did all those
copies. Now his wife.
Now his wife.
Yeah.
So eventually I still was listening to tapes at this point. I was thinking that they were better, but finally I listened to the MP3s and realized, oh gosh, these are clearer. So the last 8 sessions, starting with 99, I listened to the digital versions and could actually hear more. So once I finished, I still wasn't 100% happy that I really had, you know, the definitive version. And Carla and Gary were, you know, excited, interested in the project, and interested in the idea of producing a book, you know, with the versions. And I said, well, gosh, I'm just not, you know, I'd like to listen to them again. And but I realized fairly quickly that it was probably going to take me another 6 years or however long that had taken. And Gary arranged for, he said, well, let's get some volunteers to start with the wiki, the re-listen version, and then work from that. And so he recruited 3, and it's grueling work to listen. And 2 of them dropped out, but 1, a guy, and speaking of, you know, people all over, a guy named Eric Lyman in San Francisco, faithfully listened. He started at 106. The idea was he would start at 106 and work backwards, and I would start at 1 and work up. So he made it from 106 all the way down to 31.
Wow.
And I think I made it from 1 up to maybe 6. but what I started doing instead of listening myself was just taking Eric's transcripts, and then he carefully indicated the changes he had made, so I would go with timestamps, so I'd go back and compare just that little section and see if I agreed with him, and mostly I did.
Mm-hmm.
And what Eric introduced was really getting basically every sound that Don made. We didn't still do ums, but times where he would start to ask a question one way and then change and ask it differently, like, are you saying, do you mean, what I'm trying to say is. I had kind of been glossing over those, and Eric put them down. And so now we have, I think, really extremely accurate versions of sessions 31 through 106. Unfortunately, Eric has gotten busy and doesn't have time to do the last 30, or the first 30, as the case you know, is. And actually, there will be some changes in there. Just as I was preparing for this evening, I was listening to one of the early sessions in the digital version, and a question that I had marked as inaudible, actually, I could hear very faintly, but, you know, you can make it out. So we are hoping to find another volunteer who could maybe find the time and energy and effort to re-listen to those first 30 sessions.
Yes.
Toby, I was wondering if our listeners might like to actually hear a clip from these sessions so they can have an idea of what you're talking about when you say how grueling it is to listen to these.
Yeah, that's a great idea. And maybe it would be nice. I actually prepared just the part of that opening question and answer that you read that was different. And that might be a good example of Ra. It's clear, and you can hear how slowly Ra speaks, and you can actually hear the new material. So that is 95 House.
All right.
We suggest that you then request of this living entity that it now be welcoming and absorbent as for the vibrations of harmony, love, and a thanksgiving which this group shall then, as the incarnational experience proceeds, offer to the domicile.
So that's
okay.
That's what it sounds like.
Wow. We really want to thank you, Toby, for taking this on, because I can imagine how difficult it must be to actually listen to that for hours and hours and actually get the pronunciation, the punctuation and everything, and end up with a finished product that we can actually read and follow in a flow. So,
yeah.
Wow,
yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah, you find yourself tuning out constantly, I do, or thinking about it, and you got to go back. But really, I had it easy, because the one who really did the hard work, of course, was Jim, who's here with us. And, you know, honestly, there were really very few changes, considering how long it is, how many hours of tapes there are. And a lot of the changes.
And what pressure he was under to finish it. Don was always hovering over his shoulder going, is it done yet? Can I read it?
Is that right?
Yeah.
I think Don actually had the harder job by far, because he was sitting there and hearing these words for the first time. He couldn't press rewind and say, you know, what did you say, really? He had to formulate questions on the basis of what he had heard just then, and that just amazes me.
You're right, and I've got a great example of that. Maybe can we play another clip of from session 73, and this wasn't published before. Ra actually misspeaks and don't realize that they misspoke, and Don catches them. This is Monica 73, infringement.
Those who state that no working comes from it, but only through it is infringing upon free will.
You said that if the entity says that no working comes from it, but only through it, it is also infringing? Is that correct?
This is incorrect. We said that in that event there is no infringement.
So that was fascinating, because that was actually published the way Ra meant to say it. But even when Don asked them, they didn't realize that they had said it wrong.
One thing I do notice listening to that is that you don't really even have to know what they're saying to get the feeling of an atmosphere. When you're listening to the words, you're listening to the energy that goes along with the words. It really puts you in a different kind of a place.
You're right. It was really interesting to me. When I use a tape player and I'd want it back up, I'd keep it on play and then press rewind, and you can hear the little sound of the voices. And Ra's voice, actually, when you did that backup thing with the squeaky, was much more resonant, much louder than Don's. Ra really projected, even though they spoke very softly often, there's kind of a timbre there or a fullness that I think most of us don't usually have in spoken, you know, communication, like a presence, and I think that's maybe what you're alluding to.
Mm.
That's interesting that you picked that up even going backwards.
Yeah. I could always tell when Don stopped and Ra started or vice versa.
Toby, could you talk a little bit about the differences in the sessions? I mean, why are you doing this? For the sake of those who already have the books, or maybe they've read the books online at llresearch.org, what's the purpose in this? What are we going to get? What kind of additional information can we find?
And it's a question, you know, why are you doing this, that I have asked myself.
I'm sure there's some tasty gems in there. I mean, we already found
there
one
are.
There, and I'm sure there's lots more.
There are. Maybe not lots, but there are enough that it feels like it was worth it. And I'll give you some examples in a second, but the overview I have, or where I come to understand this, is, you know, this is just a remarkable thing, if we believe it is what it says it is, which, you know, I do, that you have a sixth density being, mind-body-spirit complex, speaking through, you know, to us on Earth now through the veil. And it just ought to be. It just feels to me like it needs to be as accurate as it possibly can. Plus, Ra was so careful to be precise, as precise as they could be. And so it's kind of honoring that effort of theirs to be as precise as we can be also. But to give you some examples, there were some new questions and answers. And I think maybe it wasn't, because Jim, I asked you about that this summer, and you thought that you guys thought when you published book 5 that you were publishing everything. But some of the new questions and answers are maybe a little marginal. like about cattle mutilations or Maldek or Lemuria. There were a couple that were interesting. There was one about pyramids, about that a rod, pyramid built of rods, why the energy is the same as a solid-sided pyramid, and a few others. But the most interesting parts for me, I think, were the lines that were dropped, maybe because of the typesetting issue we were talking about earlier. And I mentioned a couple. There's one that I was really glad to find, which was in the section about the tarot. Ra gave a general answer about birds, winged figures, they called them. It's kind of like the house one. When you read it without the missing line, you almost think it makes sense, but you don't quite maybe get it, but you think, well, maybe I'm just not quite getting the tarot still. So they said, the winged visions or images in this system are to be noted not so much for their distinct kind as for the position of the wings. All birds are indeed, and then this is a new part, intended to suggest flight and messages and movement, and in some cases protection. The folded wing in this image is, and then it's back to what was published, intended to suggest that just as the matrix figure, the magician, cannot act without reaching its winged spirit, so neither can the spirit fly lest it be released into conscious manifestation and fructified thereby. Monica, do you think we have time? I actually prepared a clip of that, which is interesting both for that new material and because it illustrates the fact that even though Ra typically spoke in a very monotonous voice, the questions that they liked, they actually allowed some inflection to creep into their voice, or not just creep, but they really sound engaged.
About a minute. Yeah, we got time.
It's 91, it's wings.
Okay, here we go.
All of birds are indeed intended to suggest light and messages and movement, and in some cases protection. The folded wing in this image is intended to suggest that just as the matrix a figure, the magician cannot act without reaching its winged spirit. So neither can the spirit fly, lest it be released into conscious manifestation and fructify thereby.
It's awfully quiet. Could everyone hear that? I don't know if you can play them any louder.
I could hear that.
I don't think there's a way to do that. But I could make out every word, but I could tell what you meant by Ra being more animated. There was definitely an uplifting, a lilting to the voice.
Yep, exactly. And you can get that in the printed transcripts from the O student, because they just were into it. Well, I'm wondering if maybe I have some clips that aren't so much about changes as they were. One of the really interesting things for me was just it gave me so much more insight into the process and the sacrifice and the effort that went into creating these sessions. And I had a few clips from the early sessions, but they're very faint, so I don't know if it's worth trying to play them or not.
Well, if some of our listeners are listening, what's that?
I said, why don't you
give it a whirl?
Give it a
yeah,
whirl.
Yeah.
All right.
Just all right. Any of our listeners that are listening, and if you want to give us some feedback, you can go to the chat room at blogtalkradio.com/LLresearch. Sign into the chat room and give us feedback on how well you can hear these, okay? That would be appreciated. Okay, now which session was this, Toby?
So let's play the very first one. This actually, Carla, yeah, the very first session, of course, they didn't know Ra was coming. They didn't have the protocol of walking the circle of one, Carla going into trance, any of that. It was just a regular conscious channeling. And so it's actually the only time you hear Carla say the opening, I am Ra, because always after that they waited until Carla had left her body and Ra had started speaking to begin taping. So, yeah, will you play one beginning?
Okay.
Can kind of hear that's actually Carla speaking. It's not monotonous. It's not trance. You've got some intonations. And then if you play two opening, this one I think she is in trance. And actually Carla, so they had a time, they before each session they would say, you know, Ra session, whatever, and the date. And often it was Jim that said that, but this time it was Carla. So you hear Carla's regular speaking voice, and then you hear her as Ra immediately afterwards. So this is two opening.
Number two, Ra take number two, 120, 81. Ra. I read the love.
Now, I have a question for you, Carla, and Jim. Being what Toby just told us about the tapes, you couldn't actually hear Ra saying, I am Ra. But it's kind of understood among the Law of One community that the sessions that didn't include I am Ra, there was some question about some distortion coming in. So we always thought there was a big significance in that. Is that not true?
It is true that the significance of it, of course, is a tuning mechanism. The repetition of a name tunes the person to the vibrations of that name.
So if the tape was only started after Ra had already said, I am Ra, then how did the person transcribing it know whether that was said or not, I guess is my question.
Well, Mickey was sitting right there, listening.
Okay. So, Jim, so basically, you did the transcription right afterwards, and that's how you knew.
Afterwards, yeah, that was
okay.
He's done pecking at his heels like a mad rooster.
Ah.
Is it done yet? Is it done? Is it done?
Yeah, there was no way.
Something you guys said this summer that I hadn't realized that I thought was fascinating was that, Carla, you weren't allowed, Don wouldn't let you read the sessions until maybe the 23rd or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. It was just pitiful. Toby, they'd come in and give me this look and say, does your mind-body-spirit complex have a distortion towards fullness / hunger?
And you didn't know what they were talking about.
And I was trying to follow with every bone in my body. Okay. I'm hungry. I think I got that I'm supposed to tell you that I'm hungry. Okay, let's go eat. I was so blind, and finally I got down to ask the question, you know, can Carla read this stuff? Because he's a scientist. He didn't want to pollute the material.
Yeah.
In fact, this whole
thing
is very satisfying to the scientist and all of us, the archivist, the librarian, whatever, who likes to know that this is the real thing. You know, there is, you know, the original tape, it's been listened to, this is what it said. I think there's a great comfort in that, which we didn't really have until the re-listening project.
Yeah.
Toby, I have a question for you. You had outlined, at the website, the beta website that's not actually up yet, that you're still working on, which will be released soon, I understand.
Hope so.
You have a list of some of the restored lines, and one of them, for example, session 7.12, a restored line, some of these landings are of your peoples. But that line is actually already in lawofone.info. So have you already updated some of the stuff in the lawofone.info?
I did. Some of the ones I was really excited about, I just went ahead and did.
Okay. All right. Well, we have about 10 minutes left. Were there a few other sessions you'd like to share with us, Toby? Or...
I'd love to, but if there's other things to do instead,
no,
that's
please.
Good too.
This is the time to look at this.
Okay.
I know one thing I'd like to hear about is any progress you've made towards planning actual publication.
Yes, I. My thought is that the. The nice thing about the edited, originally published books is that they read nicely. And I am questioning whether all the false starts add to that. And so my current idea is actually to have three versions. So I have on this beta site Monica mentioned, I've created... an original version, which is the originally published book 1, 2, 3, 4 with book 5 spliced back in, and then a re-listened version, which is the actual transcript, including indicating the blank, you know, the parts that we couldn't verify. And then I'm aiming towards a kind of compromise or a middle version, mostly re-listened, but just smoothing out maybe a few of the rough edges in Don's questions. All of Ra's answers would be the same, except there actually are a couple places where Ra's answers were edited, and I think correctly. We played that example of Don catching Ra in a misstatement. There are a couple other possible misstatements that he didn't catch. For example, Ra said, let's find it. Speaking of first density, you may see the air, it was published as, you may see the air and fire of that which is chaos, literally illuminating and forming the formless. Well, that makes sense. Air and fire, illuminating. What Ra actually said was, you may see the air and water of that which is chaos as literally illuminating and forming the formless. So in cases there's three like that, I've indicated what they said and then kind of put in brackets what I think they might have meant. So to answer your question, Carla, what I'm doing, so I've got all the Ra's answers ready to go, and then I'm splicing back in Don's questions, the re-listened versions of Don's questions, and just smoothing them out a little. And that, I started working on, and I realized it was taking too long because I wanted to get these other changes uploaded. So that I think I will continue to do, but I don't think it will take years. I think it's, you know, months. Thing.
Wow.
And then, so, but the main thing is re-listening to the first 30 sessions. I think that really should be done because they were the first ones I did, and so probably not done quite as well, and also on the little tape player, and I think the digital versions are better. So I think there's still some, especially Don's questions, to be improved there.
Yeah. Okay, that sounds really beautiful. I think there are a lot of people that are itching to have that in their hands.
Yeah, me too.
Definitely, definitely. I have a question for you, Carla. What do you think, well, do you think this kind of illustrates the point about not making this into a doctrine of any sort? I know you've stated on the air before that you really don't want the Law of One made into a religion. And yet I see people on the discussion forum battling quotes the way that the way they do with Bible quotes.
Throwing numbers at each other, yeah.
Yeah. This says this, and then they really get down to, you know, where one word can make a huge difference in interpretation. Yeah, but that word, because of that word, you know, and they use that one word to back up a particular, you know, belief. And in light of the fact that there may have been a few words, you know, that have been missed, even by Ra, could have been,
sure,
there could have been some distortion here and there. Do you have any comments on just the idea of taking this so, you know, literally as a doctrine?
Well, I've been very outspoken on that. I've been outspoken both about the material and about us personally. The one who would have been the greatest of cult figures, of course, was Don, who died early. So it was difficult for people to get their hands on him. But Jim and I are still alive, and there arises an attempt now and again to put us up on some kind of pedestal, and we don't belong on any kind of pedestal. We're just like anybody else, living our lives and doing the best we can to live up to our belief system. And it just so happened in this lifetime, Jim and I, all the things that we did apart seemed to bring us inevitably together to serve in this way. But I would be the last person to encourage an overzealous discussion of the Law of One. I think that the concept of free will is so important here, and you have to remember that your free will stops at the end of your nose. You don't have the free will to expatiate upon whatever it is that you feel is important for everybody else to know. It's very possible that nobody else wants to know it. So to me, it's always been a matter of, well, if somebody asks you about it, then, you know, feel free. You know, suit yourself. Just talk all you want, share all you want, you know, be real excited about it, that's fine. But unless someone actually is asking you about it, it's not fine just to carry on about how you really ought to read about this. Yes, you can drop a little kind of a seed of thought now and then, just a sentence here or a sentence there. And if there's fertile ground there, somebody will ask about that seed, and you'll be able to go forward. But mostly it's a very good idea just to relate to people on the basis of how can I support you? How can I help you? How can I be of service to you today? And not on the basis of what you think might help them, because you're not in their body. You're not walking in their shoes. So definitely I'm against a mindless, a mindless obedience or a mindless adherence to every word there. saying that, you know, every word in this book is absolutely true and all that stuff. It's such good material. The tendency is to do that, and, you know, just sort of jump over the top, over the edge, and say, no, this is totally different, and Ra would never screw up, you know, so I'm just going to take that everything in here is absolutely true. Well, I wouldn't. I submit absolutely everything to my own judgment system. And if something doesn't make sense to me, then it doesn't make sense. It doesn't mean that I don't find it interesting. It means that I don't necessarily believe it because I'm told it. And I would hope that people would take the Law of One that way and work with it to increase their spiritual maturity. It's a great tool. It's a great resource. And I encourage people, you know, to use it if it works for them and to put it down and move on to something else if it's not working. So I'm very laid back about it. And I see, you know, time after time after time, it's helped this person, it's helped that person. And up to the point now where, you know, probably thousands of people have written in and thanks that we have made this material available. But that doesn't mean that the next person that comes at it is going to be a raw person. It's just as simple as that. So you really have to wait for the opportunity. And I do think that what Toby has done is remarkably, you know, makes things so much simpler. You never have to find your place now. You don't have to depend on page numbers because he's got every question in the entire work numbered uniquely. So all you have to do is know that, and you can find it in a matter of seconds. And I think that's extremely helpful. But that doesn't mean that you're supposed to treat it as if it were, you know, famous quotes from the Bible that will save you when, you know, Satan is on your tail. I definitely am the last person to encourage that kind of thinking. I just encourage people to think. What are your thoughts today, you know? Start from the very beginning and go from there. And build up your own intelligence. Make your own decisions. You don't need another soul to tell you what you need to do for your own spiritual health. But just do what you think is right and be fearless about it.
Okay. We are just about out of time. We just have a couple of minutes left. Toby, do you have any quick thoughts to conclude with here?
Well, I alluded to it earlier, but I think when I look at the big picture, I think that it has been worth it. And I think really the original goal was a good one. I think reading the sessions with the law, with the Book 5 material back restored to its rightful place, deepens and enriches the sessions, because I think the Book 5 material in a lot of ways is the heart of the raw material. It's about Carla, Jim, and Don's personal journey and Ra's, and it makes it all come together nicely.
Any idea when this might be available? I know you're working so hard on this, Toby. I'm sure you have a life, too, but any idea when we'll have some news on this?
Soon, I think. The last piece that I think I want to do before I publish it is make it so that people can search the, I mentioned different versions, re-listened version and original version. Just give them a choice when they search. You can already browse either one. I want to make it searchable, and then I think it'll be ready to roll out.
Okay. All right. We are actually out of time. Thank you so much, Toby.
And thank you.
Thank you for joining our show. Thank you, Carla. Thank you, Jim, the original scribe, for making this all possible. You have been listening to LL Research's In the Now with Carla L. Ruckert. I'm your host, Monica Leal. We had Toby Pelock and Jim McCarty on our show tonight. Please visit our website, llresearch.org, and bringforth.org, bring4th.org. We'll be here next Friday, as always, at 8 o'clock Eastern Time. Thank you so much for joining us, and we will see you then.